Welcome back to Movie Recap. Today I'm gonna show you a 2011 American biographical drama film called, J. Edgar. Spoilers ahead. Sit back, relax, and enjoy the video. The movie begins with Edgar Hoover, director of the Federal Bureau of Investigation, FBI, for almost 50 years, is talking to Mr. Irwin about communism as a threat to the United States. For Mr. Hoover, this idealism corrupts the mind of the great men, and turns them into fascist, and vicious people. Mr. Hoover fusses about the increasing crime rates, the deviation from an authority, and the scorning of law and order. In his vision, these fatal acts can kill their nation, and turn into an anarchic system if remained unchecked. After Mr. Hoover and Mr. Irwin have their conversation, the writer from crime records named, Agent Smith, arrives. Mr. Hoover commands them to set the agent up a typewriter in his office. Agent Smith is there to document Mr. Hoover's side by telling how his journey in the FBI starts. These will be documented by listening to Mr. Hoover's narration, and typing it on the typewriter. Mr. Hoover started his narration way back in 1930 by describing his first in the Department of Justice named, Mitchell Palmer, an attorney general. Mr. Palmer did not believe in war, until he was targeted for fighting the radicals, just as Mr. Hoover had experienced. One night, Eight's bomb exploded across the country. Some senators, cabinet members, a Supreme Court justice, and other threats against Bolshevik communists were targeted. That same night, Mr. Hoover rode his bike, and went to Mr. Palmer's house. He saw how the norms of the investigation were clumsy, and messy during that time. The inspectors used the buckets to clean up the broken glasses caused by the bombing instead of collecting them. Mr. Hoover also saw the firing weapon was thrown away instead of taking its fingerprints. He picked up the leaflets that he saw on the ground to serve as potential evidence. That moment, it awakened Mr. Hoover's eyes to see the importance of science in a criminal investigation. Going back to the present, Agent Smith leaves after Mr. Hoover narrates the first part. Days after the bombing, Mr. Palmer had set an emergency meeting with Mr. Hoover. He met Helen Gandy, a typist, on his way to his office. He was mesmerized by his beauty, so he asked for her name to show his interest. After the meeting he had with his boss, Mr. Hoover told his mother about Mr. Palmer, who insisted Mr. Hoover to lead the new anti-radical division against the Bolsheviks. Mr. Hoover told her mother that he already had names of suspected radicals, and aimed to have 1,000 of them by the end of the month. After telling the great news, Mr. Hoover bid goodbye to his mother to date Helen. Mr. Hoover and Helen met at the Library of Congress. Helen was amazed by the high ceiling, and sophisticated ambience of the place. Mr. Hoover led their way to shelves where card catalogs are placed. In his proud voice, Mr. Hoover said that he helped organize it, saying that this organization was helpful to immediately look for books in minutes than it used to take days before locating. He took that as an avenue to share to Helen how great it would be if every citizen in the country were uniquely identifiable using their cards and number, patterns of fingers, and even how quickly it would be to find people who committed crimes. Helen was impressed with Mr. Hoover's idea. After a few moments, Mr. Hoover asked Helen to be his partner, but Helen refused. Mr. Hoover gently accepted her decline, and offered Helen to be his secretary, which Helen gladly approved. The next day, Agent Smith comes to the office to know about Palmer's raid. Since he gains Mr. Hoover's trust, the director brings him a desk inside his office. Once again, Mr. Hoover starts to narrate. Before Mr. Hoover moved to the FBI office, it is powerless. There were few federal laws, and no firing equipment to carry. All criminals can freely go over the nation because there was no law for tracking their identities. Therefore, Mr. Hoover decided to compile note cards of names of people who seem to be a threat based on two categories. First, if they are foreign citizens. Last, if they committed violence. Mr. Hoover contacted the Department of Labor, which is in charge of deportation. He proposed arresting those who would meet the two criteria he mentioned, but they did not cooperate because no law supported his idea. Despite the department's rejection, Mr. Hoover continued to do his plan to identify every radical person in the country. He wanted to know their location, their colony, and spoken language. He ordered his four men to break down every card, and arrange them into subjects and categories. To make his plan feasible, Mr. Hoover's team exposed the sham marriage of one radical activist named, Emma Goldman, which led her to be scrutinized in the court, questioning her identity of being an anarchist. In every question, Ms. Goldman refused to answer, leading her to be deported. After Goldman's case, the FBI agents alongside the local police began to raid where communist radicals could be found. These people were armed, and were prepared to kill just to escape. In a bomb factory where they raided, Mr. Hoover saw leaflets on the table, matching those he picked up in front of Mr. Palmer's house. Preceding those raids, they solved bombings, arrested nearly 4,000 communist radicals, and deported over 500 of them. After clearing the radicals out, The bombing stopped and peace arose again. People had forgotten about the danger, and their fear flew away as if it had never arrived. The political opponents attacked Mr. Palmer after trying to protect the nation against communism. People have no objection to it, which made all the FBI men take away their commitment except for Mr. Hoover. Days after, Mr. Hoover received an appointment from Attorney General Harlan Stone to come to his office. There, Mr. Stone assigned Mr. Hoover to be the director of the Bureau of Investigation. Mr. Hoover promised to take the job for specific conditions. First, the Bureau must detach itself from politics, recruits must have a college degree, an appointment must be based on their skills, the promotion will only be made if proven by their ability, and if it will only be responsible for the Attorney General. Mr. Stone's approved his conditions, which made Mr. Hoover accept the job. On his first day as an acting director, Mr. Hoover lined up men who wanted to be part of their department in the hallway. In his authoritative voice and upright position, he said the qualifications those men must possess to be part of the Bureau. First, he must have the integrity to eliminate the possible criticism he may receive. Second, he must be physically fit. Third, he must be an educated person. Last and above all, loyalty. There, Mr. Hoover met Agent Williams, Agent Caffrey, and others. He accepted them, but Mr. Hoover removed all agents that did not fit his standards, including Agent Strokes. In a dinner, a person who took a law degree from George Washington University named Clyde Tolson was introduced to Mr. Hoover. When they had their conversation, Mr. Hoover asked for Mr. Tolson's contact information. The latter gladly gave his card number to Mr. Hoover before they parted away. A few days after, Miss Helen Gandy read Mr. Tolson's application. It stated that he is well-educated, highly recommended, and guarantees 5 years of service. His reason for applying is to gain experience that he can take for private law practice, but he has no interest in staying in the Bureau for a long time. In addition, Miss Gandy said that Mr. Tolson had received a letter of recommendation from the executive assistant of the Secretary of War. This information hooked Mr. Hoover's interest, and set up an interview. After that, Mr. Hoover entrusted Miss Gandy to keep his records about a person in a position of power. It contains harmful information, and Mr. Hoover cannot assign it to anyone, but Miss Gandy. Therefore, they agreed to create a confidential file. Mr. Hoover went into Attorney General Kennedy's office a few minutes later. Mr. Hoover had the audio scandal of Kennedy's brother. Mr. Hoover said that he would leak it unless they allowed him to follow groups of people who seemed to be an immediate threat. The attorney did not accept nor refuse his offer, and asked Mr. Hoover to go and leave the transcripts of his brother's scandal. After meeting Attorney General Kennedy, Mr. Hoover met Mr. Clyde Tolson. The applicant said that he may not have the best resume, but he outstands others in terms of honesty. Mr. Hoover's accepted his application, and gave him the benefit of the doubt in his honesty if the opportunity would prove its truthfulness. A few days later, horrifying news spread in the whole nation. The child of Charles Lindbergh, the country's president, got kidnapped, so Mr. Hoover and Clyde pulled over to investigate. He saw possible evidence to explore, such as the shoe footprints, the ladder, and the ransom note. The president came down to express his gratitude, and shook Mr. Hoover's hand. Mr. Hoover asked for the letter and the ladder instead, but the police declined his request. They wanted to let Mr. Hoover go, and assured him that the investigation would be under their control. This made Mr. Hoover and Clyde, frustrated with the president for trusting the local police over the Bureau. At the United States Congress, Mr. Hoover urged to pass a law that makes kidnapping a federal offense. He argued that the power of the Bureau would mean nothing if there were no federal laws, weapons, and without the authority to arrest. Mr. Hoover also requested to create a central file by gathering all the fingerprints in this country. This had been granted, and every fingerprint across the nation was collected. In his office, Mr. Hoover asked Miss Gandy about the humor of reorganizing the Bureau. Mr. Hoover then asked her to copy him the file they created about Mrs. Roosevelt. Days after the president's son got kidnapped, Lindbergh entrusted criminals to locate his son. Also, he got an offer from Al Capone, one of the country's enemies, to help pay the ransom money that the kidnapper requested. But in the end, he hired John Codon to act as the middleman between the kidnapper and the president. While the president entrusted his hope to criminals, Mr. Hoover and his team started to build the Bureau of Investigation's technical laboratory. He hired experts to investigate the kidnapping with him. Mainly the wood experts to analyze the ladder, and a graphic expert to examine the handwriting of the kidnapper in the ransom letter. Also, because the ransom had to be paid, they would have to trace the bill. On one hand, Codon and President Lindbergh got a letter from the intermediary of the kidnapper. It was stated in the letter that his son could be found in the boat between the two islands, but there was no boat. In his office, Clyde enters and confirms Mr. Hoover's plan to track down another communist. The director refuses to consider his concern about the possibility of Mr. Hoover's false suspicion, and the latter requested Clyde to order the wires. On another day of the documentation, Mr. Hoover narrates about his lunch with Clyde. Mr. Hoover told Clyde that he got an appointment with the president. He was there to show the transcript about Mrs. Roosevelt's intimate moment with a communist agitator. The president seemed to be uninterested in the file, and asked Mr. Hoover to resign. Therefore, the director concluded that he is afraid of the foreign invasion. At that moment, the president signed a secret order granting Mr. Hoover an increased power to investigate after communists and radicals, even without a warrant. After they ate, Mr. Hoover asked Clyde to be his associate director. After searching for a long time, it was found that the president's baby was found dead near his home. The body was blackened, his left leg was gone, and a fracture in the skull. 6 weeks after the kidnapping, the Lindbergh Law, which makes kidnapping a federal offense, was passed in Congress. This made Mr. Hoover continue to investigate and work with scientific experts. This demanded more funds because the FBI could not afford laboratories. Another day in the Congress of the United States, Mr. Hoover pleads to support their investigation by providing them with advance force. Senator McKellar doubted his request and questioned the distribution of the FBI's fund in advertising. Also, he asked Mr. Hoover's qualification of becoming the leader of the FBI when he had not experienced yet to arrest someone. Mr. Hoover argued that he was in charge of the investigation, despite feeling attacked. Fuming with anger as Mr. Hoover and Clyde left the Congress, Mr. Hoover ordered Clyde to make a file about the senator, and to be monitored by four agents all the time. To pull his ego up, Mr. Hoover started to personally arrest criminals such as Mr. Karpis, Mr. Mahan, Mr. Runette, Harry Campbell, and William James. After getting funded to match the blades on the East Coast with the wooden marks, Mr. Kohler, the wood expert, traced the shop of the purchased wood. The information flowed smoothly until they asked questions to neighborhoods in the city. People described him as a man with average height, high cheekbones, pointy chin, has a German accent, and stated that the bill was deposited to Walter Lyle, who manages a gas station in Lexington. Carrying the information, they gathered and the bill, the FBI immediately went to Walter to ask about the alleged kidnapper. They found that the man had once been there at the gas station, and Walter even wrote the man's plate number at the edge of the bill. After several investigations, they found that it was a German carpenter who lives in the Bronx. His name is Bruno Richard Hauptmann. Mr. Hoover, together with his team, were watching over Bruno as he drove his car away from his house. Before he could get far away, Mr. Hoover got down on their car, pointed his firing weapon at Bruno, and personally arrested him. At present, Mr. Hoover gets another audio tape about Martin Luther King's affair with a woman. As he listens to it, he gets disturbed by a call from Agent Shanklin. The agent says that the president has been shot. Mr. Hoover immediately calls Robert Kennedy to tell the news, and before he reacts, Mr. Hoover hangs the call. In their dining area, Mr. Hoover tells Clyde about his plan to send the king a personal letter containing Mr. Hoover's threat of having an audio tape scandal. Mr. Hoover will send the tape to the press if he accepts the award. Mr. Hoover's disgust about the king is immeasurable. He finds that he is not a good leader, but a fraud, degraded, abnormal, and foolish, making him a threat to the country. Days after, Mr. Hauptmann was brought to trial, and evidence was gathered against him. The graphic expert showed the comparison of Mr. Hauptmann's writing to the ransom note, the markings on the wood and his tool were identical, and Mr. Lindbergh also heard his voice when he had a conversation with Codon. With all these, Mr. Hauptmann was found guilty of murder in the first degree. In their living room, Mr. Hoover asks Clyde to join him, and watch the awarding ceremony of the king. Mr. Hoover is excited to see how the king will decline the Nobel Prize. Upon watching, Mr. Hoover and Clyde are shocked when the king accepts it. To his disappointment, Mr. Hoover immediately switches off the television. On the road, the marching band leads the motorcade of the 37th president, Richard Milhouse Nixon. Mr. Hoover watches how the president and his wife happily wave to the cheerful crowd. In his office, Mr. Hoover is terrified and crying. He asks a favor to Miss Gandy to secure his private files. Mr. Hoover is afraid that Nixon will tear him down in the bureau. The president did not fire Mr. Hoover, but he wants to know what the director had in the files about him, even though he knows what it contains. If they do not cooperate, Nixon will create his private force to remain in his position. Clyde suggests they retire, making Mr. Hoover question his loyalty. Clyde confesses that he read the manuscript he made with Agent Smith to prove his loyalty. Clyde knows the truth. Mr. Hoover did not arrest Karpis, kill Dillinger, being welcomed by President Lindbergh, and he did not arrest Hauptmann. The manuscript was written to glorify him. As Mr. Hoover listens, he looks down, and says nothing against Clyde's statements. Days have passed, Miss Gandy receives a phone call, saying that Mr. Hoover has passed. Nixon hears this news, and immediately goes to his hidden files, yet they fail to find them because Miss Gandy secures them in a vault. Clyde goes to Mr. Hoover's home, takes his steps upstairs to his room, silently whimpers. As he walks slowly, he tries to hold his tears until he sees Mr. Hoover lying half-naked on his floor beside his bed, lifeless. There, Clyde bursts into tears, grabs the blanket on Mr. Hoover's bed, and wraps it around him. The movie ends with the statement showing Mr. Hoover's files will never be known, and Clyde's grave is also buried a few yards away from Mr. Hoover's in the Congressional Cemetery. Thank you for watching. Subscribe for more videos like this to help the channel out. Have a nice day.